Compassion is an interesting topic. It may seem that trying to help the world right now is compassionate. But you can also look at it another way, and that is to say the worst thing that could happen to those in this world right now is to feel as if they're dominating truth. Enlightened ones, ones are here to help them, as if they're dominating them and putting them down. And that may be the worst thing that can happen to them, because that actually increases their fear. Sometimes people reach a point where they can't seem to help themselves, and they attack those who are there to help them. That actually makes them feel more frightened deep down. They may think, hey, we're winning, we're getting rid of truth here. We're getting rid of what can help us. And that's, again, this world is a place where those who believe in failure or success come to. But the more they fail, the more frightened they get. So how compassionate is it really to play this game with them? Because it's making their situation worse. So my perspective, one perspective that I'm seeing is that it's better to not be here during this time when there's this triumph of technique over isness, apparent triumph of attention on technique, which is a way of trying to deny isness, just the isness. There's no technique to isness. Reality doesn't have any technique yet whatsoever. Truth doesn't have any technique in order to be true. Truth is not the outcome of some technique. So when we have this obsession with technique, which we do in the world, there's a put down of that which is witnessing to isness. There's a tremendous put down of it. Now, those who are putting it down, putting those who the wisdom down, thumbs down to wisdom, those who are doing that, they feel that they're triumphing. This is very important for them. Because they're failing, and they think failure is success. In other words, they're keeping their stance of hallucination that reality is at the mercy of as an outcome of some technique. They feel they are an outcome of some technique, the technique of nature, which is none of this is true, it's an hallucination. It's better that they don't feel that they're triumphing. They look around, we don't see any teachers anywhere. No triumph, Wow. and then later when they start to repent, where they actually are eager for help and reassurance towards salvation, where they see teachers of God in a positive light, that's when then they can be helped. But one way of viewing it, which is I'm seeing, it is better to not be here and to not help. There sometimes it's better to not help when those you're helping aren't in a state of mind where they have the power to marginalize and put you in a negative light and put you down and seem to triumph over you. That actually then makes them worse delay. See, the whole issue, the Holy Spirit looks at the whole situation as one of delay. How to minimize delay. That's it. So compassion really is how to minimize delay. That's all it really is. And so we have a difficult time knowing what to do, because the Holy Spirit doesn't have these ideological positions at all. It simply sees it. How do we minimize it? How is delay minimized to dropping this dream of technique? I've always had very little interest in technique. I just say keep it simple. Just drop technique. Keep it very, very simple. Don't know how machines work. Don't know how manufacturing works. Don't know, all this technique in the world. I just don't know anything about it really. And I see it as unimportant, because in reality is manifestation. There's no technique to reality. There's no technique to experiencing. only in hallucination is there seem to be technique, and hallucinations are not real. So now, keeping this moving forward, focusing forward here, as we need to do, it's possible that the most compassionate stance at this time is to not be here, actually, is to be somewhere else. And let the obsession with technique run its course, run riot. Okay, let that happen. You may think that, oh, that's horrible. They're reinforcing all this stuff. No, they're consuming them. It's being burned out. They're burning themselves out. Let them burn themselves out with technique. And then when they repent and they say, wow, this isn't what I want. I want the isness. I want isness. I want to be free of technique. Then they will reinforce themselves in a positive way by having a positive viewpoint of those who can encourage them towards the truth, reinforce and encourage, you know, good right habits, right practice, good focus, attention, all that. There'll be a positive cycle out of that. Right now we're in the super negative cycle. Now, I talk about the super negative cycle that the world is in right now. And the Holy Spirit has brought to my attention. This happened on September 24th, and I'm reminded of that big Jesus the Redeemer white balloon floating over Melbourne, Australia, with the number 24 on it. Hashtag keep the faith. Very interesting. So I'm looking at it a different way. There's a very, very potent symbol, that balloon before the World Cup. And on September 24th, what happened on that day is essentially we have global martial law right now, but even more than that, we have a new world religion. We have a new world religion in place. And of course, the President of the United States is the head of this new world religion. He's the one that established it, which is what he came here to do, which is many people intuitively realize this, noticed it about him. He says the office of the presidency is way beneath him. His role is to establish a new global world religion. And that's exactly what took place on September 24th. There is a new world religion. There's 193 nations. All the nations of the world agreed on some basic parameters for a new world religion. And a new world religion is a stance, ultimately, against isness. Against isness. And it's very humorously ironic that the ISIS is, okay, and they have a stance against isness, but they're using the bad boy poster child of that, you see, to make it seem legitimate what they're doing. But ultimately, they're taking a stance for technique, against the isness of being. It's a religion against religion. It's the new world religion is a religion that is against religion. It is against truth. It's taking us, so there's a global stance against truth. It's very important to note that when the U.S. president visited the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem, where it said that Jesus Christ was born, his mannerisms, the way he acted was, he acted as if he was doing Jesus Christ a favor by even being there. Okay. And just the whole attitude that he had portrayed there, the attitude he portrayed was not one of reverence, was not one of humility, was not one of repentance, was not one of saying, I'm a sinner, I have tried to change reality, I've been trying to find some technique to change reality, and I have a severe continuity problem, and I know that Jesus is completely free of all continuity fear, as well as any desire to change reality, and therefore I know that this is profound, something very profound for the world and helpful for everyone. This is the global religion of truth is signified here. You get no indication of any awareness of that whatsoever. Instead, he thought he was acting as if he was doing a favor to Jesus Christ by even being there. So, you see, this is an attitude of someone who feels that they're going to establish a global new religion to replace the other religions. To replace, and of course they say their target is religious fanaticism. Well, their target is really religion, period. Okay. Religion is the way back to realizing we never left. Okay. It's the way back to realizing we never left. And this is so difficult because we think that we've done some technique. We've done no technique. We've done zero technique. We had never done anything at all. So it's the way back to accepting, realizing and accepting we've never done anything at all. We've never taken the first step towards changing reality. And of course, this is a path of humility because we're certain that we've fundamentally altered reality. And that now, well, maybe we're restoring it, you know, we're restoring it, or making it better, or something like that. This is the delusion of nature. So we have a nature religion, a religion of delusion, a religion against religion, religion of technique. It was founded on September 24, 2014. And this religion already has a global martial law police state apparatus that's been okayed by 193 nations to enforce compliance with this new religion. It is a new religion and compliance will be enforced. This is what the Holy Spirit is showing me, and I'm just saying, well, I see what you're saying. You know, this is one interpretation of it, and could be very valid, very valid. Of course, most people say, oh, no, I don't see it that way. Well, fine. But the point is that there is a globally enforced compliance apparatus, and the last 50 years have been the working to establish this and get all these countries to agree with it and people in the countries to agree with this New World Religion, New World Order, global martial law, compliance with the New World Order, police state. Ideological in many ways. And of course most people think this is great because they believe failure is success. Failure to drop the stance of hallucination they feel is success in keeping their identity, which they think is based on technique of what? Of nature. And of course Jesus tells us there is no such thing as nature. There is no technique. That's why he walked on the water, did all the miracles, raised Lazarus from the dead, raised himself from the dead. Not only raised Lazarus from the dead, he raised himself from the dead, cured lepers. There is no such thing as nature. There is no such thing as process. All this is just an appearance in the now, appearance in the now. It's all one seamless appearance. There's not many appearances. There's just the one total appearance right now. So the Holy Spirit's interpretation leaves me thinking, you know what, the whole idea of the exodus from this planet, of the wise, of the repentant, the exodus of the repentant, is very valid. It's very valid because it doesn't those who are insisting compliance with this new religion that's against religion, that wants to, a religion of stamping out religion, true iconoclastic, iconoclastics. Compassion will say it doesn't help them at all to succeed in what they're doing, to stamping out. You know, they want to crush religion. Now, what if religion, the repentant ones, what religion is really means the repentant ones, those who have repented and the discipline that they insist upon in their lives. That's religion. Religion is not something that's imposed. It's something that's from within. It comes from repentance and the willingness and the desire, the eager desire to say, I want to be free of suffering. I'm tired of delusion. I'm tired of hallucination. I'm tired of feeling that I'm a product of some process or technique. You know, and if we believe we were created by some process, then when we see there is no process, we naturally assume that there is no me, there is no I. Now, when I was in the non-dual abidance, I realized that I still have this sense of individuality as far as while I'm here, but I'm also everywhere. I'm both here and everywhere, simultaneously. It's like that, and conceptually, we cannot understand that. but the experience was fine. I felt like, well, I have sort of a sense that I'm here. And I also realize that here is everywhere. Here is everywhere. So, you know, this is something we have to only, you have to experience it. You cannot intellectualize this. Reality is not an intellectual technique. It's not an intellectual realization. We have the pseudo-intellectuals who think that happiness is some sort of intellectual realization or emotional realization. It's not. It's an actual experiencing of reality. So maybe this exodus from the planet of those who have repented will take place. Shift to another locale. So that this new world religion, which is anti-religion, pseudo-intellectual, anti-truth, pro-technique, won't have us to kick around, you see. They're feisty and desirous of bullying us, you see, and pushing us around. And they'll just have to push themselves around. You see, and see how that works out. See how they like it. Because it's all geared up for incredible. Third Secret of Fatima talked about how this massive attack on religion took place and the slaughter of the religious people on this planet. Horrible, horrible situations coming. What if we weren't here? So then all this hostility and anger to push around, you know, we're not here. And so what are they going to do with that? They're going to end up pushing each other around. And maybe that will help them repent. Because you don't make any progress until you repent. You cannot. You cannot. You're only trying to triumph over God prior to repentance. You're trying to change God by believing that you are an outcome of process. See, there's no process in reality whatsoever. There's absolute freedom. Every moment, every awareness is completely free, always. It's not, moments are not tied together as we think of nature as a process. It's not true. It's an appearance. Every moment is a solid, one solid appearance of the totality of the entire creation. Is the one appearance right now. So if we're not here, then they're going to have to deal with that. It's like the bully, there's nobody to bully. What happens to the bully then? So it could be very compassionate to do that because the bully may repent. And then they can take a positive viewpoint of religion, which is just your own internal discipline, your determination to set down the delusion that you are the result of some technique or process, which is the delusion of your own death, right? When we believe we're the result of a process, we're believing in death, our death. We're insisting that we're nothing, we're dead, because there is no process. So seeing there's no process, we think, oh, that undoes me. No, if there's no process, how can we be undone? There's never any process in the first place. You see, this is the non-dual teaching that it's like, wow. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. So there are those who are saying that the return of Christ is imminent. But what does the return of Christ mean? Exodus. Could very well mean exodus of the repentant ones from this place. This presumed place of presumed process. None of which is true. Because not only is the writing on the wall, it's there in bold colors. Okay. 193 countries this planet unanimously agreed on a vast range of parameters and bureaucracy. Okay. Which is, you know, how a religion established, we have these convocations, synods or whatever, where all the bishops get together from different countries. What happened was, and they say, let's elect a pope. All right. Or let's elect, you know, let's set a bureaucratic apparatus in place. Let's put a bureaucratic structure in place so we all operate in cooperation, in harmony. The United Nations is exactly that. And the United Nations called all the peoples, all the representatives, like bishops from all over the countries, 193 countries, and they said, let's set up this apparatus. Let's agree to a constitution. What they really did was agree to a new constitution, a global constitution, that will coordinate all countries of the world in many ways, in many, many ways, especially the use of technology, with a common aim, with a common goal, common aim, okay, and presiding over this great convocation of nations was the United States president, gave the keynote speech, that we're going to follow through on this. It's not just a talk, this is a basic framework. This is the framework now that we're going to use going forward, and we are going to follow through on this to the utmost. That's his message. This is the establishment of a new religion in the world, a new institution in the world, a religious institution that targets religion, actually. And of course, they're using the bad boy bully as an example for justifying this. But the real goal is religion in general. Their actions previous have been made it crystal clear, and all their minions who follow them made it crystal clear this is their objective. You know, this is, and they haven't raised a single finger to chastise their followers, the fanatical brown shirt followers, really ideological Nazis, actually, who can tell they're just foaming at the mouth, rabid dogs ready to set upon religion. And they've never said a single word about, no, this is wrong, this is bad. They just kind of smile, because they know, you know, that they're going to do their bidding, what they want to have done. So they're not fooling anybody. They're not fooling the Holy Spirit, which is all that counts. Those who repent have the Holy Spirit to turn to. The Holy Spirit is not fooled in the slightest bit. So it's go time. And many people say the return of Christ is very imminent. Very, very imminent. That's possible. It's very possible. People are having dreams of rapture all the time now. This is feeling like something is going to happen. So the background of that would be, that's the compassionate move to make. It's the compassionate move. It's the responsible move to make. It's to leave them to their own devices for a while until they repent, right? So until they have a positive view of those who help them towards on the path of repentance, which is the realization that nothing ever happened. And then, once they get that positive relationship going, then they'll really make great progress. But if they short-circuit that by developing a super negative relationship to the point of feeling that they have destroyed and crushed and conquered and defeated and hated, and they're going to suddenly say, oh my gosh, this is how I have treated those who were to help me, and they'll go on this fearful guilt trip. You know, we don't want to lay a guilt trip on these people, no way. Because they are us. We're part of the one family. It's just that they're lost in this hallucination and the continuity fear for now. So you don't want to lay a guilt trip on them. I don't want to. That will just delay them even more. And this idea that somehow they're so wicked that they're going to be annihilated is not true. It's not true. Laying that guilt trip on them makes it worse also. Anything, you know, the bully wants those that they can bully. That's what the bully wants. So the bully probably wants us to stick around. So they're friendly. Like, oh, sure, folks, no problem. Stick around. It's like the Jews in Germany in World War II. They say, oh, no, don't worry. We're just tightening some screws up here, you know. Stick around. Everything should be fine. Don't worry. They didn't want them to flee because they wanted to bully them, you see. The bully doesn't want you to flee. That is for sure. So they have all these people in the world now saying, oh, no, there's everything will be fine here. Tolerance is the name of the day. Yeah. We're just, all we're doing is targeting some real terrible people or cutting off people's heads, and that's it. Nothing more than that. But really, you know, is that really true? It's not. That's an excuse. You know, the bully starts out by attacking another bully, okay? In the school, you see how that happens, right? And first the bully claims they're a champion of the people. Why? Because you know what? There's that terrible bully over there that is bullying some people, and I'm gonna go out there and really crush that bully. And people say, oh, that's great. But what you don't realize is the one that you're aligning with is a worse bully. And they're just trying to get your allegiance to them by picking on some other bully, which is a little bully, you know, a little pipsqueak bully. They say, I'm gonna crush them, I'm gonna crush this bully, I'm gonna crush this bully for you. See, yeah, look, I'm getting rid of the bullies for you. And then you don't realize that they're the ultimate bully. Okay, you don't realize that until it's too late. Because you're not coming from a standpoint of love and forgiveness and the Holy Spirit. That's the problem in the world. So the bully wants you to stick around. The bully wants you to be within range so they can bully you. That's what gets them off. That's what they feel. It makes them real, you know, to demand process. You know, we have process. Remember, we believe our identity is the result of process. And truth will show us there is no process, no such thing as process. So if we demand an identity based on process, we're in terror of reality. We're in terror of truth. We think truth is out to kill us, out to destroy us, out to make us nothing. No, but truth is out to show us we've never been. Our identity has never been the result of any process. In fact, there's never been any process at all. So how could we have an identity based on process? It's a hallucination. So a hallucinated identity is not a true identity, but we've taken a hallucinated identity as our identity. So of course we're scared to see this. And so we will align with bullies who will insist, you know, on this, you know, jackbooted process for everybody and project the fear out of non-being out into the world, scapegoat, you know, all this stuff. No repentance there. No repentance. Repentance means to say, wow, I've been hallucinating that my identity is based on process, an attempt to try and change reality, attempt to be greater than God. And I realized that this leaves me with this fear of annihilation. Should I stop hallucinating? And it also leaves me, but in order to overcome that, I feel like I need to leap into reality, you know, like that. And I'd be overwhelmed by it, you know. And so we have a continuity fear. It is true that there is this seemingly slight shift that takes place, but it's almost imperceptible, really. Seamless. Where you do see differently. You see, oh, there never was any path. There never was any process take place. Then you realize it. But it's not overwhelming. It's not overwhelming. It's actually relief. That is relief. But I would say that this relief would grow and expand, you know, and so it seems as if there's some sort of, you know, momentum to it, like it gets more greater and greater and greater and greater. And so of course you might feel frightened of that. It's a continuity fear. So the fact that we're going bit by bit gradually in no way means that we agree with the process or technique. We're backing out of process, the belief, and we're backing out of technique. Okay, we're using technique to back out of technique. Using technique to evaporate our belief in technique. Like that. So the practices we use here are to back out of conceptualization, back out of technique, back out of all the stuff that is supporting the idea of identity, process-based identity. So the new world religion is worshiping process-based identity, plain and simple. And they want to eliminate the religion which helps us back out of this delusion. And make no mistake, their desire to eliminate this is fundamental to them. Fundamental. They're fundamental extremists, actually. Fundamental extremists. Their desire to eliminate, okay, true religion, true repentance on this planet. And of course, this big bully of fundamental extremism, of liberal progressivism, they're again using the old trick of, oh no, we're your friends, we're getting rid of this bully over there. They're using that excuse. They're the real bully, and they're trying to get you to lie, to let your guard down and say, oh, you must be my friend because you're getting rid of that little bully over there. Now, they're not your friend at all. They're the big bully. They're the religious extremists. They're the fanatical extremists, actually, fanatical extremists who want to get rid of all repentance on this planet, all backing away from the delusion of process-based identity. They want to eliminate it. They want to exterminate it forever. That's fanatical extremism. And of course, they're the ones who are saying they're targeting fanatical extremism, where they're the actual fanatical extremists themselves. This is complete Orwellian, upside-down madness on the planet right now. So the Holy Spirit's pointing this out to me, and you know, I said, I'll say what you show me. I'll publish it. You know, of course, people will start going thumbs down now. You know, the fanatics are, having been exposed, they're start, you know, putting thumbs down now on the videos because they've been exposed. It's been brought to light. This whole scam, this whole scheme has been brought to light now in a clear and compelling way. And of course, people say, well, wow, you know, this, no, we don't want you to see that. We want to be able to bully you at some point, because the last thing they want is for those who repent, or path of repentance, backing away from process-based, the delusion of process-based identity, to be out of their control. You know, that's the last thing they want, because they want to feel as if they're in control and dominating and denouncing, you know, and putting them down in terms of saying you're wrong, we're right. If they're only talking to themselves, you know, they feel like, wait a minute, but we're not forcing others to agree with us, you see, and they feel like there's, because within they still know the truth is still within them, and so they're projecting it out there, and there's nobody to, you know, to project it upon so much, this fear, and then attack them, and so then they'll start to implode, the whole structure will start to implode, and then they'll reach a point where they feel, I have to repent, this doesn't work. Of course they don't want that, they're afraid of that, but that's actually compassion for them. That's compassion. It cuts through the delay. So, I've not been able to establish any foothold in this world, really. Even though I've asked the Holy Spirit a million times, help, I don't have any foothold here. Not been able to, so there must be a reason for that. Must be a reason. Now, we may think that, well, if we come back later, they'll be so, you know, weird that we won't be able to relate to them. No, the repentant are not weird at all. The repentant will say, hey, there's something that's helping me, like some kind of grace of God. What do you call that? We can call it whatever you want, but we can call it the Holy Spirit, Spirit of wholeness, holiness, oneness, Spirit of oneness. They say, yeah, I reached the bottom. I've asked for help. The help arrived. And so right away, you're on the same page. Because if you understand the path of repentance, then you'll understand anyone who's repentant automatically. So, and you don't have to understand the unrepentant. There's nothing to understand there. You just have to wait until they repent. Doesn't matter what style madness takes at all. Doesn't matter at all. Because eventually, all of those will implode and bring you to rock bottom. Bottoming out, repenting, and turning to the Holy Spirit. It's that simple. So it doesn't matter. You don't have to track what the world is doing at all. You don't have to track. We don't have to be here to track the events of the world. Like, I've stopped looking at events and news and all of that stuff. I'm practicing doing that. And to a large extent, I am doing that. I don't really know what's going on in the world right now. Except that Holy Spirit said that one thing, the 24th, said that you need to be aware of that. It's very important. So I did look up that and read the resolution and all that, and because that's a pivotal tipping point of history here. But other than that, I'm not sure what's going on in the world. I'm just looking at the baseball games, pretty much. And even that, maybe I shouldn't pay so much attention. Because it doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter what what style insanity dresses up in. Okay. It only matters when it repents. Then the path of repentance, I know very well, having taken it. Then you just encourage them. See, that having a clear overview of the path of repentance is what's important, and that's what will be lost sight of during now this new world anti-religion, this new world order institution of anti-religion, this anti-religion religion. What will be lost sight of is the path of repentance, and that is, if you want to be a teacher of God, you have to be very clear about this path and how it works, and the phases it goes through, and the difficulties, and the struggle, and how do you back out of technique? What technique do you use to help you back out of technique until eventually you realize you don't need any technique to be what you are? That has to be very clear to help. And when there was a world dedicated to making that totally taboo to even think or talk about that, you can easily lose all clarity about the path. And one way we know that this is taking place now is the almost incredible ignorance of the world right now about the traditions, okay, of the greatness of this path of repentance throughout history. Ignorance, extreme ignorance, extreme disinterest. Okay, for sure, this is a sign. You see where their attention is. But when I grew up, I had just this tremendous, insatiable desire to be aware of the saints and the sages of the past, of the traditions, of the history of it, the river of repentance. That's all I focused on my whole life. Whereas today, all that people are focused on is technique, 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 technique. Thinking they're enhancing what they are, since they believe they're a product of technique. A process. The more they learn about technique and process, the more they feel that their identity is being stabilized, is being affirmed. It's a way of just affirming a non-existent identity, actually. This world is right now is a way of affirming a non-existent identity. What good is that? It's endless. There's no stable outcome. That is there. No stable outcome. Affirming a non-existent identity, how much fun is that, and how long does that fun last? Not very long. Because it's always fearful. It's always feeling like, wait a minute, you know, I'm not affirming it as much as someone else is affirming it. And maybe that means mine is not, maybe it means mine really is not existent, and theirs is existent, mine's not. There's always within, we have this feeling that, hey, my identity is non-existent. I'm affirming a non-existent identity, and if I stop affirming it, I will cease to exist. So we're terrified to stop this apparatus of affirmation, affirming a non-existent identity. And so we have this cult, the newest New World Order cult was established on the 24th of September, 2014, who's obsessed with affirming a non-existent identity. And as such, they have no interest in the history, the tradition, and the transmission of the path of repentance. And when you lose clarity about that, then you're really lost. Then you're really in a pickle, because there's nothing to turn to. And we may think, well, we need to stay in this world to establish it. No, because they're going to take great delight in dismantling this. Okay, great delight in dismantling this. And I've had those who from other places in the cosmos that are actually here, and their histories from other places in the cosmos, who are experts in dismantling this, and they've expressed to me what great delight they take in completely dismantling the whole history and tradition and transmission of the path of repentance, and they're eager to just absolutely annihilate it, and they view this as a supremely positive goal for them. Completely upside down and backwards situation. So they're here, and they're here big time. Don't overlook the power of fanaticism, extremism. Take this, you know, tremendous relish, delight in destroying, being iconoclastic and trying to destroy the transmission of repentance throughout the ages. They're fiendishly active in what they do. We've seen it happen, communist China, for instance, Soviet Union, around the world in various movements. And now we have this global movement that is designed for that. And they take this, you know, fiendish delight in it. And are very effective in they cow the population, they cow the people, and they, etc. So it happens all the time, and it's ready to happen now. So the exodus of the repentant ones, those who have repented, deciding, you know what, it's better for these dear members of the one family of perfect love that we, you know, sidestep them for a while. Let them have their little party. Okay, that's fine. And then when the music dies, then, and they repent, we'll be here and say, look, we have very clear understanding of the path of repentance. Don't worry. This is the one thing that they will want to hear. Right now, they don't want to hear this. They want to destroy the path of repentance. But wisdom will tell you, compassion, is this is a temporary aberration on their part. It's a temporary aberration. See, I'm not condemning anybody at all. I'm saying it's a temporary aberration from the continuity fear, from adopting the stance of hallucinating that you're the product of process. Your identity is a product of process. That being is a product of process. It's you reach these aberrational phases. And it's a temporary phase. The music will die. You know, the dancers will stop, collapse. And then the hangover will ensue. And the repentance will come. And at that point, what will they be screaming for? Desperately. Does anybody have any clarity about this path I have to go on? Please. That's what they'll be saying. And then we'll show up and say, absolutely, we're totally clear about it. We've been spending our time with Jesus, who is, you know, perfectly clear about it. And he's been transmitting that perfect clarity to us so that we are more and more confirmed in our clarity about it. And we're able to give you encouragement, because that's what they'll want. Down the road, what they'll want is encouragement, clarity and encouragement. And it's a funny thing. Right now, they're insisting that nothing better than destroy all that, and that'll make them happy forever. Why do they say that? Because anything that reminds them that their identity is not process-based freaks them out. And they think that's the cause of their unhappiness. So they think if they get rid of anything that reminds them that their true identity is not process-based, then they'll be able to affirm the this non-existent identity, which they believe they are. And there'll be nothing to interfere with that. Therefore, they will be happy. But again, how happy can you be affirming a non-existent identity? Where you got to keep working. You can't relax into that. You can never relax. So they'll eventually see that and say, wow, this isn't it. So again, the very ones who are condemning us most severely right now are the ones who will be desperately asking for our help a little bit later. So it would be very unkind to allow them to really feel as if they've trashed us so terribly. And later on they'll say, wow, I can't ask anyone for help. Look what I did. I can't trust them because they must hate me. You know, that kind of thing. They'll say, well, I just can't trust you because you must hate me so badly for everything I've done. And we might say, no. And they say, oh yeah, well, I don't believe you. You see what I'm saying? It puts a barrier there. So if you're not here to be trashed, then later on, they'll say, oh yeah, you mean you sidestepped the whole thing and we weren't able to trash you. Well, that's amazing. They'll say, I like that. That shows you really were smart, you know, really were aware. And they say, hey, I feel very differently now. I repent of my wicked ways previously. I don't want anything to do with them anymore. I realize that this is a trap that I've been in. And I see it's a delusional trap. I want to get free of this. And now I'm very happy that you are here to help me. And you were smart enough. There's a way to sidestep this. And I didn't put this big block in my way, you know. It sounds reasonable to me. I don't agree with the idea you're supposed to be martyred, you know, that you're supposed to just, you know, allow them to slaughter you. Because then they think your blood is on their hands, you know. And it's far better just that they don't find you at all. Let's say they're out to slaughter you. And, Jesus showed this many times. There are many times they were out to slaughter him, and they couldn't find him. Couldn't find him. He was right in the middle of the crowd. Well, nobody could find him. And then finally he said, okay, now I'm going to show you the resurrection. Because that's a lesson I want to teach you here. This is a big lesson, learning lesson, okay. But he said, if it weren't that I was going to teach you this lesson that you would be helpful to you, you couldn't harm a hair on my head. You couldn't even find me. You know, right? So, it's not necessarily a good thing to be martyred by this new world anti-religion. It'll make them feel guilty down the road. It'll make them feel, you know, it's far better that they say, well, we did everything we could to find you. We couldn't find you. We searched everywhere for you. We were trying to annihilate you, but we just couldn't find you. And then they say, but we're very glad we couldn't find you now, because now we really need your help. Like that. Now, of course, there may be a time when they feel forsaken. They say, well, we can't find them to destroy them, and so they must not exist. And they may hit rock bottom and then say, help, the Holy Spirit will show up. The Holy Spirit's always with us, so the Holy Spirit will never abandon us. We can always find the Holy Spirit. And then later on, we'll show up, and the Holy Spirit will say, here's some helpers to help out. And then they'll say, oh, okay. Yeah, they'll have a different attitude. Their attitude will change. And so the upshot of this is, I'm saying the time is now. The time is now. All along I've been saying it's going to happen like a thief in the night. And it already did. It came like a thief in the night. And most people have missed it. Jesus says the whole thing will come like a thief in the night. This resolution, 2187. Security Council Resolution 2187, I believe that's it. Or did I transpose to 78? I think it's 20. I can't remember if it's 2178 or 2187. One of those two. September 24th, 2014, you can find it that way. Came like a thief in the night. The establishment of global martial law, new world order, the new world religion, already happened like a thief in the night. And of course, almost everyone's missed it. Okay, but those who are been alert and aware, you know, I certainly didn't miss it. And there are probably many who are going to start waking up to this, saying, "Hey, it's already happened." And I've said all along, it's going to happen sooner than you think. It's going to come quickly, and it like that, just like, wow, easy to miss. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. It's already happened. It's already happened. So that means that the response to it is bound to come soon too. Bound to come soon. For those who realize it's already happened, it's easy then to go along with it. Say, okay, the Exodus is now. I understand it. There's no more waiting around. Those who don't realize it's happened, they're going to still be waiting for it. You say, well, what Exodus hasn't happened yet? Yes, it has happened. It's already happened. It's a done deal. And, it's like the Messiah comes, people don't recognize the Messiah. They say, no, we're waiting. We're still waiting. What are you waiting for? Well, the Messiah hasn't come. No, it's already come. You missed it. You rejected the Messiah. No. We're still waiting. We're still waiting for the Messiah. So the world may be still waiting. Okay. What are the events that we're waiting for? What are these events? They still haven't happened. Now they've already happened. September 24th, 2014, they already happened. so we just, you know, need to kind of shake off the cobwebs and start recognizing. And most people say, no, I'm not ready, I'm not quite ready. And well, you have to get ready. If you're going to be helpful down the road, if you're going to be helpful down the road. The ones that will be helpful down the road are the ones that are ready right now, recognizing that it's not helpful if they get, you know, if they don't sidestep a situation, they're only going to add to the guilt and the confusion of these ones that are already terribly confused. They won't be as viable down the road when they're desperately asked for some help. Is there anybody who say that we didn't treat terribly? You know, is there anybody that we feel like that can help us, that doesn't hate us? You know, and then there'll be some who say, absolutely, yeah, no problem. We've been in paradise and we're totally clear about the path of repentance. So again, the danger, one of the biggest dangers in this world right now is the clouding over of the path of repentance, the awareness of the path of repentance, the awareness that there's been a transmission of this throughout the ages. And the awareness of the big picture, the different phases you go through, just the overall perspective on it all. That is what their real target is. Okay, this is what I've been aware of. That's what they're really targeting. And of course, they want you to get your attention on the wars and the violence and the mayhem and all this stuff. So you get all, your attention gets all clouded over. You lose your clarity about this. They don't want there to be any path of repentance. They think that's a path towards their annihilation, because they think they're a process-based identity. And the path of repentance helps you realize there's no such thing as process. So they view it as you're taking a path towards annihilation, a path towards losing your identity. No, you're taking a path to realizing you never did lose your identity in process. Because no process ever happened, or ever can happen. So in other words, you're taking the path to realizing your identity is completely secure, always and forever, and is not under the slightest threat whatsoever, impossible. In other words, pure safety, pure security, pure love, pure peace, pure tranquility. That's the path that repentance brings you on. So I've found in trying to make videos about to keep this transmission alive, it's not feasible. It's not feasible. People misinterpret. If I put Ananda my ma, people interpret her as, oh, look at this beautiful woman, you know. I've been doing that for how long now? 17 years. And I've been evaluating the reactions to this. And almost overwhelmingly, the reactions are, wow, what a beautiful woman. She seems so wonderful. What a nice, peaceful person, you know. And almost nobody says, hey, wait a minute, you know, what is this? Really, this is like a call to awareness of the transmission of the path of repentance, to the transmission of spiritual practice. That this is someone who's here to focus our attention on spiritual practice. No, they make it about her physical appearance, her body, her appearance. Oh, she looks so peaceful and nice, and you know, and that's not it. So, I found that the mood of the world doesn't get it at all now, and despite incredible efforts, it doesn't work, because you cannot help the unrepentant. You cannot, because their belief in help is to render your help ineffectual, and then they think you're helping them. This is a fact. This is the unrepentant. This is basic dogma. The root of their feeling of security is to render all help unhelpful, and they feel that is helpful to them. So there's no way to make progress under those circumstances, except for them to implode and bottom out. So the sooner they implode, the better, really. You know, and every army gets tired, especially when there's nothing, no one to conquer. No one there to conquer. There are only armies already, you know, here to triumph. And they look out and there's nobody on the battlefield to oppose them. They say, how can we triumph? You know, they think that triumph is reaffirming their life, their identity. there's no one to triumph over. And they just like fall into depression, you know, start bottoming out. They're just as, wow, this whole triumph thing is terrible. So we do bottom out in the Holy Spirit. We do turn to help. Holy Spirit's there. And we'll all be saved for sure. Now, here's an army is all ready to attack the opponent, and the opponent's not there. Then they turn to the leader and say, hey, wait a minute, you promised us there'd be a great battle here, and you lead us into victory. And there's no opposition whatsoever. What's going on? We have to triumph here. And then the leader says, uh-oh, I got a problem here. But the leader is, of course, very sly. And so the leader says, well, I'll tell you what we do. We'll divide this army into two. Shirts and skins, okay? And you'll fight one another. And they say, well, that's better than not fighting at all. Okay. So they end up fighting one another. Like that. And then when they're tired of that, they say, wow, this is horrible. Is there anybody that can help us, you know, with this? And then those who are clear about the path of repentance show up. They show up in a world where these poor destitute ones who have repented now. And once you repent, grace, you become aware of the grace helping you out. Now, of course, triumph in battle is all about technique. It's who has the better technique. In other words, who has the stronger identity. It's a way of trying to reaffirm identity through technique, through process, using the body as a sock puppet. Anyway, the thing is that to keep the transmission alive on this planet is not really possible anymore. Just like 9/11, the restrictions, ideological restrictions that took place after that were so intense, I literally felt like I was dying. Ideologically, it was like a straitjacket. Everybody was self-centering themselves to a profound extent, and the whole world changed. It's almost impossible to remember what it was like back in the 90s, before 9/11. It was so difficult to actually feel the way we used to feel. You can't. We didn't have this fear about loose speech and joking and expressing ourselves. And you can see the people that their body language is more loose and relaxed, you know, and people got along better, actually. There's less uptightness. And after 9/11, you know, the whole ideological stance and attitudinal stance of the world drastically changed. And now we're how many years? 13 years down the road from that, right? 13 years down the road. And, of course, not the goal of 9/11 was to create this ideological drastic change. It was all planned, okay? It was all cooperation. It was purposefully done as an excuse to shift the ideology of the planet, just like ISIS is also an excuse to shift the ideology of the planet right now. And now, after this September 24th, The whole planet again is going to go through just a drastic shift in what they feel is acceptable and not acceptable, and you can already feel it, you know, this the intensity that's going on in the world. Just little bits of things trickle into me. So the Holy Spirit says, I'm not trying to shut myself off in a cave, but little bits and pieces trickle in from the Holy Spirit saying, well, you see this is what I told you, right? It's happening. I said, oh yeah, you're right. Fanatics, common sense is thrown out the window. We're in a time of ideological extreme fanaticism in the world under the guise of getting rid of extreme fanaticism. A worse extreme fanaticism is in charge now. throw out due process. Right? That's what's happening in society. Throw out due process. Guilty until proven innocent is the new innocent. Guilty to proven innocent is new global law. And, of course, in the United Nations resolution, they put all this mumbo-jumbo in there about keeping in mind that everything we're going to be doing is in alignment with our human rights, accepted norms for human rights, and making sure that we do not go against these basically agreed upon human rights. They put all this, you know, flowery rhetoric in there as filler to make you feel like, oh, okay, no problem. But our human rights, the rights have been trampled on since 9/11, trampled on. And that was just to get us used to it all. And now what's coming next is a massive quantum leap in totalitarian control on this planet. But again, the target of that, see, people think, well, I'm not being targeted, so it's okay. The target of that is to crush any knowledge about the spiritual transmission, the path of repentance, is to crush it. They'll allow, quote-unquote, religion, so to speak, churchiness, they'll allow a little bit of feel-goodness, but the overall true transmission of path of repentance, gone. This is the severity of the situation. Now it's going to be gone whether you try to fight to stop it or not. So it's better to not try and fight to stop it, is what I'm saying. Sidestep it, later come back, and when they repent, you'll be able to help them, and they'll be able to see, oh, you were a true friend. You didn't condemn me. You allowed me to have my disbelief without trying to, you know, defeat me. And you understood that I was going to change my attitude later on. So you didn't create some enmity with me. And they'll realize, they say, wow, that's very compassionate, actually, what you did. Very compassionate. And they'll appreciate it. Later down the road, they'll appreciate it. Right now, no, not so much. You see, they can't see that far. They can't see down the road like that. But later on, they will thank you for sure. It's like parents with children. You do, you know, discipline the children, they don't like it. Down the road, the children say, wow, that was really helpful. So you have to be a good parent, so to speak. You have to be, means responsible, mature. You have to let your maturity act. Let maturity act. And that is not being heroic or a heroine, or grandiose, saying, no, I'm going to stand up to this world, and I'm going to make sure we keep this transmission going. I already tried that. It doesn't work. People just misinterpret it entirely. So in line with all this and seeing that the Holy Spirit is doing nothing to help me in the future, to have a future presence on this planet, nothing. It's amazing. I have bills that are now due. I got any money to pay the bills. No way to borrow money. Can't pay the bills coming up. And I pray the Holy Spirit help. Doesn't do anything. So I think either the Holy Spirit's crazy or evil, or it knows better what's going on and maybe saying, hey, we're going to sidestep this whole situation. So don't worry. Don't worry about it. And I spent all my money I spent on trying to keep this transmission of repentance historically, to keep it alive in the world. That's what I spent all, that's what I went into debt about, was can I find a way to prevent what's happening is already in the world so people's attention is on this. And I found it's not possible. It was not possible. But I did everything I could possibly do to see make it happen, including ruin myself financially, because I believed it was worth the effort to find out. And I found out now it's not possible. So at least that's a lesson learned, you know. And so maybe the whole thing plan is to sidestep. That's what I've seen, that there's a sidestepping. And I think the most important aspect of this, one of the most, is to, again, realize that it doesn't matter. We don't have to monitor what happens here at all. Don't have to monitor it. Because all we need to do is be clear about the path of repentance. That's it. All we have to do is monitor this. is to monitor the path of repentance, is to be clear about it and not monitor what's going on here. It doesn't need to be monitored closely at all. Maybe little bits and snippets here. Just like now, I don't watch news on TV, I don't watch newspaper, I don't watch the internet. I don't monitor what's going on. No more monitoring what's going on. I don't know what's going on with Ebola. You know, I don't know what's going on with economically. I don't know what's going on with the Ukraine. I don't know what's going on in Middle East. I don't know what's going on with ISIS thing, as far as what they're doing. I don't know any of this stuff. I don't know what's going on. Don't need to. We don't need to monitor this world. So I think the fear people have is, well, how can I help people if I don't know where they're at? We're only going to help them when they repent. And you know what repentance is about, so then you'll know where they're at. They've bottomed out, they've turned to the Holy Spirit, and now they need a little bit of encouragement, some curriculum, some institution, some way, support system. They need a support system. So it doesn't matter what kind of caves they've been exploring. You know, they've been, it's like some spelunkers are underground exploring these caves, vast networks of caves, endless networks of caves, and they finally come out somewhere. Of a cave entrance, wherever, into the light, you know, and it's like, oh my God. I said, I'm so terrified of that darkness there, but the light is like terrifying too. Can you help me? And we say, sure. Here's some shade, sit in the shade. You know, we'll talk and we'll, you know, relax in the shade here. The sun's a little too bright for you, so just relax in the shade. It doesn't really matter what cave they come out of, does it? Imagine a vast underground complex of caves with many entrances opening up to the sunlight. And people have been lost in those caves, and who knows where they're wandering around in caves. It doesn't matter what, they've been wandering around in darkness. It doesn't matter what you label the darkness. So this is cave, the name of this cave is this, the name of cave. No, it's all the same, it's all darkness. So when they come out of the darkness, it doesn't matter the entrance, the way they came out of the dark, out of the cave, where that is, they're in the sunlight. So you say, hey, here, pull up a seat, relax in the shade here. It's that simple. And they may be mumbling, you know, first I went in this cave and then I went down this passageway into some other cave. And you say, it's okay, you're out of the caves, don't worry about it. And they can see you don't care at all. They say, huh, wow. How's that possible that I can forget this nightmare that I've been through? Here's somebody who doesn't even care. This is totally irrelevant. I mean, wandering around in darkness, labeling the darkness, what is that? Labeling insanity, you know, it doesn't mean anything. And then they will see it's possible. I say, wow, it's possible to get free of this terrible nightmare that I've been having. You don't have to know the labels. See, the labels don't matter. What you did in the dream doesn't matter. You don't need to label it. Just start forgetting the labels. It was all just one nightmare. It was just an attempt to make darkness seem as if it's differentiated, to make the belief in technique process as if it's differentiated. If there's no process at all, how can it be differentiated? How can what is non-existent be differentiated? So we've just been in this dream trying to differentiate what is non-existent. And you see, that's all equally absurd. All equally absurd, really. And the path is to get to the point where you can release all of it as equally absurd, right? No need to differentiate. Someone running for city council came up to the door there. So it doesn't matter who the leaders are down in the darkness. It doesn't matter what labels you give. You see? They say, well, somebody told us to go here, and somebody told us to go this way in the darkness. And I said, no, now you're out in the light. It's only a matter of getting used to the light now. The names down in the darkness don't matter, really. So it's really better not to know the names, to tell you the truth. It's really better, more helpful not to know what's going on in this world. If you're really compassionate, don't know what's going on here. Don't know any of the names. Don't pay any attention. If you really want to be compassionate, don't pay attention to this world, truly, at all. Because what everyone will eventually want to see is they say, wow, I just want to forget this nightmare. Is there somebody who doesn't share this nightmare with me? And they say, yeah, I don't know anything about it. I mean, it doesn't mean anything to me. I'll say, oh, that's great. Oftentimes we look for saints who are in different past times and we feel like, you know, they don't have any idea what's going on now. That makes us feel really good. They ask that night in my mind, yeah, what do you think about all the events, world events? She says, what world events? I'm not aware of any of that going on. And they say, what do you mean? Is all stuff happening? She says, I don't see it at all. What I see is everything's absolutely perfect just as it is. It's just one total perfection, oneness, only God everywhere. And so they were relieved by that and said, wow, that's great, because we're so caught up in this nightmare and you're not even seeing what we're seeing at all. I said, that's right. That's difficult to do when you're in the world. But so if you want to be compassionate, don't be here in the world. Don't know what's going on. I don't mean dying at all, because that's still part of what's going on in the world. And there must be some way to sidestep this situation without dying. You know, that's not on my agenda at all. Maybe we'll go to a place where we don't get old. Very possible. And maybe this phase won't last that long in the world. Maybe we'll come back here at some point. People say, well, I don't know who you are. And I said, okay, don't worry about it. I sidestepped the whole thing. They say, I don't get it. I say, that's okay. No worries. You just sit in the shade here. And if the repentant ones will say, okay, okay, okay. And they start swapping war stories. You go, shh, shh, shh. Forget about it. Forget about the dream. Forget about your struggles with nothing. It's all meaningless. It's all meaningless. Now, do I have any information exactly on how to sidestep it? Not yet. I've seen this is necessary. I've seen some, but as far as details, no. But again, we're not going to get details until we recognize that it's truly justified and relevant. Until we accept the fact that this has already happened. The new world order is already in place. The new world religion is already in place. The global martial law is actually in place right now. It is actually in place. You cannot travel. I mean, the logistics are all, the bureaucracy is all agreed upon. Now, implementing it might take a little while, of course. But it's like a earthquake in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. The tidal wave is already there. It's already been generated. The tidal wave has already been generated. It's just a matter of how far you are from the epicenter as to when the tidal wave hits your beaches, okay? So it may hit a beach, you know, in a couple of hours, and another beach it may hit in 10 hours. But the ones, imagine if the ones on the beach that are 10 hours away are saying, oh, we don't have any problem. Why should we worry? Hit the other beach. No, it's coming for your beach too. It's coming for your beach too. So evacuate the beaches for sure. The tidal wave, the earthquake that's generated a tidal wave has already happened in this world. September 24th, it happened. So it's just a question of, you know, when does it hit your beach? Don't be on the beach when it hits the beach. And so those who are aware of that are now open to hearing about details, probably. And saying, okay, I see that's justified now, I understand. What are the evacuation orders here? You know, when you're on a beach and a tidal wave is coming, what do? You evacuate the beach. You evacuate the beach. So what we're looking for is now information about evacuating the situation. You know, get off the beach. Some sort of information in this regard, some sort of exodus. And so I've certainly got my antenna up about this. I don't have anything yet, but I'm rolling this out, showing I'm capable of at least speaking up, even though this time of darkness has now descended upon the planet. still speaking up. But I realize that's not going to last very long. That's for sure. That is for sure. The thumbs down, you know, people, the crowd will start. They're being empowered now. They're being shown. Yes, all 193 countries now support you. You know, the radical activists, the extremists, who are pretending to be, you know, so nice. They're actually radical extremists, fanatical extremists. And they realize that they now have the blessings of all the countries in the world to do what they came here to do. So the grace period is not going to last here much longer. That is for sure. So I'm still speaking up, but I do realize that at some point, you know, those activists will descend like locusts, like a plague. That's the real plague that this world will be hit upon. And you can see they're all over the internet, swarming like maggots, you know, just a horrible, vicious kind of attitudes being displayed on the internet. I've been monitoring the internet in that way for quite some time and seeing the, you know, the shift in attitudes. And you see how activist are they becoming? You know, how crazy are they becoming? How emboldened are they becoming? Well, with each step that's been taken in the world by those who are establishing this new world order, they become more and more emboldened, more and more emboldened. And with this now shift of the 24th, I realize now they feel like all the gloves are off. You know, okay, we can do whatever we want to do. We'll all be justified by getting rid of extremism, religious extremism or something, right? It's the Rubik that justifies everything. And I say, well, yeah, and it'd be easy. They'll easy to generalize and spread this. They say, well, you see, you know, this is why I'm doing it. And people just say, oh yeah, that sounds pretty justified. You know? And this attitude has been, they've been training for this attitude, using all sorts of social issues to train on this. To feel like they're never wrong. They never have to reflect. Maybe they're mistaken, that no, the issue is so righteous, there's absolutely no call whatsoever for them to question any of the activism that they engage in. These are the fanatics, they're the secular fanatics who have caused so much problems throughout history, especially the 20th century, where it caused just chaos, mayhem throughout the world because of their self-righteousness. And so now we have this global self-righteousness of the global crusaders. This is a global crusade against the awareness of repentance, the path of repentance. That's their real target. Make no mistake about it. Again, they're using an easy fall guy, you know, to legitimize this whole bureaucracy. But once it's in place, the ultimate target is to completely delegitimize the path of repentance, the awareness of repentance throughout history, the focusing forward on repentance, that whole thing. They want to eradicate it and get everyone's attention off of it forever. That's their goal. That is their goal. So we're up against absolute fanatical extremists. The planet is up against this. So let them implode. And then they will repent, their attitudes will change, we'll be there to help, and all's well that ends well. That's the best message, all's well that ends well. There is no breach in the one family of love at all, no breach whatsoever, just this continuity fear at play. And sometimes the play gets pretty rowdy, you know, very unruly, gets very squirrely, very unruly, and there are phases, so we'll see how this next phase is handled, but we are certainly in the next phase now, okay? Just as I shifted and said, this is phase four as far as spiritual teaching, training, spiritual awareness, phase four, the world has shifted its phase. It's in a new phase too. And so we're just getting up to speed here, and I hope as many as possible you, it's seeping in. It's a gradual thing, it seeps in. And just see what your awareness, where your attention rests upon in going forward here. All right, very great, that's it.